Morning, all. I am Dr. P. Saran Shankar, your assistant professor. Today we will discuss about degenerations, anomalies, tumors of GIA. So we have to know what is GIA. It is a middle layer of the eye. Contains three parts, that is iris, ciliary body and choroid. The pigmented part, that is colored part, is called as the ciliary body, the ring of muscle tissue that changes the shape and shape of the lens. And the choroid is the tissue layer filled with the blood vessels. Always remember that choroid is a tissue layer filled with vessels, only the vascular part of the eye. Now we will go for anomalies of choroid. So we consider anomalies. The first anomaly you see is coloboma. Here you can see a defect in the iris showing a iris coloboma. Also, if you see behind, a lens coloboma, and also a fundus photograph, you can see there will be a coloboma in the fundus or choroid. Okay, so there are three types of coloboma, that is congenital coloboma, that is absence of tissue of iris, ciliary body and choroid, may be seen in association or independently, as you are seeing here. Coloboma may be atypical or typical. Atypical is found occasionally, whereas typical is the most important part. Is it finds it is always intranasal quadrant and occurs due to defective closure of the embryonic fissure. Next anomaly is congenital aniridia or aridremia. It is absence of the total absence of the iris. First, through congenital absence of iris, true aniridia is complete absence of iris and it is extremely rare. Usually a peripheral rim of iris is present and the condition is called clinical aniridia, as shown in the first picture, above picture. The second thing, the zonules of the lens and ciliary process are often visible clearly. Next, we go for the degenerations of the iris. The degeneration of iris are simple iris atrophy. It is characterized by depigmentation, you can see above in this picture, or thinning of the iris stroma. You can see small patches of depigmentation near the pupillary margin. Differential diagnosis of a patchy simple iris atrophy may be senile atrophic, post-inflammatory, it may be due to glaucoma or neurogenic, or due to lesions in the ciliary ganglion. Another thing is essential iris atrophy. It is a rare idiopathic condition characterized by unilateral progressive atrophy of iris. The condition typically affects young females 5 times more than the males. Initially, there occurs displacement of pupil away from the atrophic zone. Slowly, the iris tissue melts away at many places, resulting in pseudo-polychoria. In advanced cases, intractable glaucoma supervenes due to the formation of dense anterior peripheral synecdoche. The degenerations of iris are shown in the picture. You can see there is multiple iris atrophy patches. Also in UBM below, you can see there are iris atrophic patches. So it is called as iodoscasis. It's a rare bilateral atrophy occurring at a senile degeneration of patients over 65 years. It may also occur as a later effect of iris trauma. It is characterized by formation of a cleft between the anterior and posterior stroma of the iris. As a consequence, the strands of anterior stroma float into the anterior chamber. Here you can see nicely this picture. The degenerations and dystrophies of the choroid. The choroid you can classify into two types, that is primary choroidal degenerations and secondary choroidal degeneration. As the name says, the primary is due to without any cause, secondary is due to inflammatory cause occurring in the choroid. The primary choroidal degeneration, there is senile central choroidal degeneration, central areolar or choroidal atrophy, essential gyrate atrophy, choroideremia, myopic choroidal degeneration. We will see one by one in detail. The degenerations and dystrophies of choroid, here we are seeing now the primary type, senile central choroidal atrophy. It is characterized by formation of multiple drusens, a yellowish part in the macular region, which look as yellowish part. These are scattered throughout the fundus but more marked in the macular region. Here, central areolar choroidal atrophy comprises bilateral punched out circular atrophic region in the macular region. See, there are small dots and punched out lesions in the macular region. Also, there is tessellated fundus. The lesion is characterized by white shiny sclera traversed by large ribbon shaped choroidal vessels. Thus, there occurs atrophy of the choriocapillaries, retinal pigment epithelium, and photoreceptors. This gives a clue to the diagnosis of central areolar choroidal atrophy. other types are essential karyotrophy and choroidremia. You remember this essential karyotrophy because it is the one which is synchronizing with that of inborn error of amino acid metabolism, ornithine metabolism, where you have a characteristic point for progressive patches of atrophy of choroid and retinal pigment epithelium. This disease begins in the first decade of life with symptoms of night blindness and progresses to involve the whole fundus by age of 40 to 50 years with the preservation of only macula. So it is one of the inborn error of metabolism. Okay. Whereas in choroidremia is a hereditary choroidal dystrophy involving the males. The disease begins in the first decade of life with symptoms of night blindness, fine with patches of choroidal and RPE atrophy. The lesions progress slowly by age of 40 years, almost whole of the choroidal tissue and the RPE disappears. At this age, the fundus feature is whitish tail with overlying retinal disease. And the secondary choroidal degeneration, I told it is a sickly after inflammation. Occurs following inflammatory lesions of the fundus. It is characterized by pigment clumping. Optimal feature resembles of RPE, hence it is known as pseudoretinitis pigmentosa. As we go off, we will discuss about the tumors of the uvea, that is, the tumors arising from iris, ciliary body, and choroid. First, this is a small brief classification. Tumors of choroid that can be classified again as benign and malignant. That benign, you have the nevus, hemangioma, melanocytoma, choroidal osteoma, whereas malignant is melanoma. Always think malignant is melanomas. Okay. Then next, tumors of the ciliary body where you have benign hyperplasia, benign cyst, middle epithelioma, and again melanoma is malignant. And tumors of iris, benign is nevus, benign cyst, nevoxanthus endothelioma, and the malignant again here is melanoma. So the malignant melanoma of choroid we will discuss. Is the most common primary intraocular tumor of adults, usually seen between the age of 40 to 70 years, rare in blacks and comparatively more in whites. It arises from the neural crest derived from pigment epithelial cells of uvea as a solitary tumor and it is usually unilateral. The pathology, the tumor may arise from pre-existing or de novo from the mature melanocytes present in the stroma. It may occur in two forms. One is a pedunculated tumor, another is a diffuse tumor. So remember this point, it is also called as Hollerstedt tumor. Initially it appears as a flat, slate gray which becomes raised and pigmented. A growth eventually ruptures through the Bruch's membrane. It is called as Hollerstedt tumor. Further growth of the tumor produces exudative retinal detachment. Diffuse melanoma spreads slowly through the uvea without forming a tumor mass. It accounts only 5% of the case. So most common is a circumferent or pedunculated one. In it, the symptoms occur in later stage. So this histopathology is very important. According to the modified calendar classification, there are spindle cell melanomas, epithelial cell melanomas, excess cell melanomas, and necrotic cell melanomas, of which spindle cells are comprised of 45% of the tumors. All such tumors have best prognosis. Okay. These epithelioids are large oval or pyramidal cells with large nuclei. These have worst prognosis, make about 5% of the tumors. Mixed cell melanomas, these are from both spindle and epithelioid and intermediate prognosis, 45% of the tumors they represent. And necrotic melanomas made the remaining 5% of tumors. The predominant cell type is unrecognizable. So these are the four classifications in pathology of these tumors. The clinical features, it goes through stages. The quiescent stage, glaucomatous stage, extraoccularization, and distant metastasis. The quiescent stage, during the stage, the symptoms depend upon the location size of the tumor. A small tumor located in the periphery may not produce any symptoms. By the signs, fundus UVC, a small tumor limited to choroid appears as an elevated pigmental oval mass. Rarely the tumor may be AML or notic. A large tumor which penetrates the Bruch's membrane grows into a subretinal dome shaped shape. Other features can be subretinal intraretinal hemorrhages, choroidal folds, vitreous hemorrhage. This is the associated features. So you can see a small or large oval mass extending into the vitreous. Next is glaucomatous stage. Because of the narrowing of the venous outflow, pressure of the vertex, veins, blockage of the angle of anterior chamber by forward displacement of the tumor or iris lens diaphragm, they may go in for a glaucomatous stage. The patient complains of a severe pain, redness, watering, and ordinary blind eye. The conjunctival signs will be the conjunctiva ischemus congested, cornea may show edema, anterior chamber is shallow, pupil is fixed dilated, lens is usually opaque, affecting the back view. Okay, it will be like a acute attack stage of congestive glaucoma. Next is the we will discuss about malignant melanoma. This is a stage of extraocular extension and stage of distant metastasis. Due to the progressive growth, the tumor may burst through the sclera to the limbus. The extraocular spread may be around the perivascular space of vortex rings or ciliary vessels. Rapid fungating into extraocular tissues resulting in marker proptosis. Distant metastasis, usually not known, dead more occurs in liver and is the commonest cause for death. So, we have to investigate for all these things. So, the first one is interophthalmoscopy. It allows three-dimensional stereoscope view of the lesion. It also depicts the presence of shifting fluid, which is a pathognomonic of exudative retinal detachment. Then you go for transformation test. It indicates a tumor mass and thus helps to differentiate from choroidal detachment and a simple retinal detachment. We have both UBM, ultraviolet microscope, also a B scan to help outline the tumor mass in the presence of a hazy media. If the media is clear, you can do FFA and to determine the value of there is a pathognomic pattern or not, or you can use radiative tracer or MRIs. The treatment is observation. While the diagnosis is doubtful, observation has indicated small asymptomatic lesions. Conservative treatment to salvage the eyeball should be instituted when there is no doubt of diagnosis. The tumor is not very large. The conservative management can be brachytherapy, cobalt 60 or iodine 125 plates, external beam radiotherapy with protons or helium ions, transpupillary thermotherapy and transpupillary local resection and stereotactic radiosurgery of the eye. Enucleation can be considered if the tumor size is more than 16 mm basal diameter or more than 10 mm, typical height in which conservative methods to salvage are not effective. Excentration or debulking with chemotherapy radiotherapy in the extraocular spread. Palliative treatment with chemotherapy and immunotherapy may be used in prolonging life of the patient with metastasis. Next, the benign tumors of the choroid are nevus. Asymptomatic lesions are flat, large, gray, usually feathered margin. Just warranties are regular follow. Melanocytoma is a rare tumor which presents as jet black lesions surrounding the optic disc. Choroidal osteoma is a very rare benign tumor which presents as elevated yellowish orange, typically in the posterior pole. It affects the young woman. Also, we discuss about the choroidal hemangioma. It occurs in two forms. Localized choroidal hemangioma, it presents a raised, dome shaped salmon pink swelling. It is situated at the posterior pole of the eye. Whole-length retina may show serious detachment, cystoid degeneration, pigment epithelial mortality. Fluorescein angiography is usually the diagnosis. Diffuse choroidal hemangioma, it is seen associated with Sturge-Weber syndrome, causes diffuse deep red, ulceration of the fundus. Next, the tumors of the iris. Again, it has the nevus, malignant melanoma and nevus xanthoma endothelium. This present nevus is most common lesion of the iris, present as black pigmented circumscribed lesions of variable size. Early a malignant change may occur, it should be observed. Nevoxanthoma endothelioma is a rare fleshy vascular seen in babies. It may be causing recurrent hyphoma, treated with X-rays or steroids. Malignant melanoma, it presents as single or multiple rapid growing vascular nodules. It spreads in the angle producing the secondary glaucoma, may penetrate through the limbus and present as epibulbar marks. The treatment is wide iridotomy, iridocyclectomy and enucleation. Tumors of the ciliary body are benign cyst as well as medulloepithelioma. It is a rare congenital benign cyst, otherwise called as dichotomyoma. It is a rare congenital tumor arising from non-pigmented epithelium of the ciliary body, represents first decade of life. Benign cyst is hyperplasia, insignificant lesions of the ciliary body. And malignant melanoma, it is a single multiple rapid growing vascular nodules expressed through the angle producing secondary glaucoma. It may penetrate through limbus putting epibulbar mass. The treatment is wide iridectomy. It is performed for tumor limited to the iris. Iridocyclectomy is required for tumor involving iris ciliary body. Enucleation performed in the melanoma associated with secondary glaucoma. So these are the tumor that is affecting the iris ciliary body in choroid. Mostly all of them will be similar in treatment as well as stages.